Well, hello there. Welcome to Unit 4 on Systems of Particles and Linear Momentum. Let's get started. So we're going to start off with center of mass. And center of mass is something that comes up not super often, but it is a good thing to know. It's a pretty easier formula than the other ones. So the translational motion of the center of mass of a system is the same as if all of the mass of the system were concentrated at that point. So what does this mean? This means that if you move an object from one point to another point without rotating it, so translational motion, you can think of it as like taking, you know, little like if you have an object over here and move somewhere else, you can think of it as like drawing vectors like for each little bit of mass and like moving it to a new point. And all those vectors should be parallel. There should be no rotation. So translational motion, when we think of like a rigid object, not a point particle, what we can do is instead of thinking about the rigid object, we can consider it as, we can just consider the center of mass of it. And we kind of treat that center of mass moving. Now, one thing to note is that the center of mass is different from center of gravity. Center of gravity is dependent on the gravitational vector field. So if you orient an object standing up versus lying flat, the center of gravity might change. It won't always coincide with the center of mass. All right. So these are the formulas that we're going to be looking at. And there's two sets. So the first set is kind of like, you know, you have a discrete number of bodies, like maybe you have like three masses and you want to find the center of mass of that system. And then you have the integral version, which is if you have something that's more, you know, continuous, you can't sum it up easily. And all this is saying is that the numerator is taking kind of like a weighted average, you could think of it. Well, like the numerator is taking like the mass times the exposition, and we're dividing by the total mass. And in total, this is kind of like a weighted average where the weight, x, is the position, is the x coordinate. And of course, you know, we take this here and we do the exact same thing for y, except that instead of weighting on x, we weight on y. This will make more sense than in the example. Now, the same version, but in integral form, is instead of, you know, the summation turned into an integral, and then dm is basically what m is. And you can think about like the denominator, the integral over dm, which means that we are summing up, you know, an infinite amount of these really small masses. In total, this will sum up to the total mass, which is the same thing as this denominator. And of course, same thing with YCM. All right, let's look at an example. So what is the center of mass of this system? So the first thing to do is to classify this question. You know, we see this problem, we're like, okay, it's a center of mass problem. Now, is it discrete or is it continuous? Well, it looks pretty discrete to me. You know, there's three masses here. We can sum those up. Don't think there's going to be calculus involved. Now, how do we do this? Well, we can just plug it into the formula. So the center of mass, the x-coordinate of the center of mass, and remember, this is a system on a 2D plane. So when we look at the center of mass, we're going to have a certain point is going to be called the center of mass, but this point has both an x-coordinate and a y-coordinate. So we want to find them separately, and combined, that gives us the center of mass. So xcm is equal to, we said, a weighted average, right, where we weight using the x-coordinate. So it would be 0.5 kilograms times the x-coordinate of this mass, which is 1, plus 4 kilograms times, you know, the x-coordinate is 1. Similarly, 3 times x-coordinate is 2. And then we divide it by the sum of all the masses. So it's 0.5 plus 4 plus 3. And we get 1.4. Same thing with y. So we take the first mass, we get 0.5, and then we weight by the y coordinate, which is 3. So we get 0.5 times 3. Over here, we get 4 kilograms times, oh, here the y coordinate is 0, so we get 0. And then we add in 3 kilograms times the y coordinate here is 2, And then we sum up the masses and we get y coordinate of 1. So the center of mass will be roughly over here. If you think about it, it kind of makes sense, right? Like you have a really, you know, a small mass over here. You have another mass that's like 8 times as much as that one over here. So yeah, I would expect it to be closer to this bottom mass than the top mass. And yeah, it would be a little bit skewed to the right just because of the presence of this mass, but it won't be skewed that much because, you know, effectively you have 4.5 kilograms here and 3 here. So sanity check makes sense. All right, that was pretty easy. Now, another way of thinking of center of mass. So, you know, we said we can look at the x coordinate, you can look at the y coordinate, combine them, and that's your xcm comma ycm. But additionally, we can say that we can think of this as a vector. So we're going to integrate over the mass, but we're going to weight it by a vector. And the vector is like from the origin to that point, to that mass. So don't worry about this if it doesn't make too much sense. I don't think this will, you can always do the other method on an AP exam. And yeah, just remember, center of mass is a vector, right? And in this case here, right, it'll be pointing from the origin to the actual center of mass, so it'll be a vector. And I have a bullet point here saying it. We can do this when it's difficult to separate the x and the y components. One trick is you can try to rotate the frame. So in this example here, if everything was like slightly rotated, you can rotate your coordinate system and find your center mass with respect to that coordinate system. Another trick. All right, here's another example. Find the center of mass of a bar where its length is L and the mass per unit length is C times X cubed, where C is a constant. Okay, so its mass per unit length, okay, is C times X cubed. So this varies with X. So the higher X is, the higher the mass per cubic length. I want to find the center of mass in terms of L. All right, so I'll draw a little picture over here. This is the bar, and this is 0, and this is length L here. And yeah, we know that at some point, right, as we get here and here, it's going to become more and more dense. So here it's a little bit shallow, and then becomes more and more dense over here. And yeah, we don't have discrete masses this time, so you know we have to do some work here with some calculus. And what we'll do here is we are basically going to we're going to use this calculus formulation. And there's, you know, two components here. So this is a one-dimensional problem, so we only have to worry about the x coordinate per se. And if you remember, the denominator, like when we were doing the center of mass, is the integral of dm. So the denominator is this right hand side that I'm drawing over here, and the integral of dm is just the total mass. So we can start off by first finding the total mass. And what is that? M is equal to the integral of 0 to L. I actually have on the next slide a little bit cleaner. We have this over here, right, is the form that we're using. And first we're going to find the mass, which is the integral from 0 to L of C times X cubed times dx. And just to think about it here, this is the mass per unit length. So the mass increases as you get further and further away. So if we want to find the mass at a certain coordinate, let's say we want to find the mass right over here, what we have to do is we take like a little snippet over here, like a small amount chunk, and we know the mass per unit length of it is whatever this value is. Maybe let's just call this x naught. So we know that the mass per unit length is c x zero cubed. Mass per length times length would give us mass, right? So a mass per length times length would give us mass, just from like dimensional analysis, or you can think of like density formula. So what we have to do is we have to multiply this value here by a small chunk, and that'll give us approximately, right? Because it varies with x, so we can't make this width too big, because then one part will be more mass than the other part. So we multiply it by dx. So you can see that over here we have mass per length times length, which is dx, and we're going to integrate it, so we sweep from 0 to L, and when you do this integral you end up getting c times L to the fourth over 4. Remember, c is a constant, so you can pull it out of the integral. Now, the numerator of the center of mass is the same thing, except now we're multiplying it by x, right? So it's integral of x dm divided by the integral of dm. So what do? We basically take this exact same formula, but we put an x in it, and that gives us our weight, so our weighted average in total. So after doing this integral, you get c times L to the fifth over 5, and putting these two together, we get the center of mass is this here divided by the numerator divided by the denominator, which is the total mass. So we end up getting 4/5 times L, and that would be about over here. Would make sense, right? Because the center of mass is kind of like your equal distribution on both sides, like equal mass on both sides, and over here it's going to be closer to the L side because that's where it weighs more. Oh, looks good to me. All right, and now for the main topic of tonight, which is momentum. Oh, linear momentum. So we've done forces, we've done energy, we did kinematics, right? Newton's laws, all of that. Now, momentum is a measure that deals with the mass and the velocity of an object. So you kind of have to put away the energy that we did a couple of weeks ago now. It's been I'm trying to pace it out so it matches up more evenly. So like do leave a comment if we're going too fast or too slow. It's hard to sync up. But yeah, anyways, momentum is a measure that deals with the mass and the velocity of an object. So the intuition is that momentum describes how long it takes for a given force to reduce velocity to zero. So kinetic energy is kind of how far it takes for a force, because you throw a ball, right? And then you have like a you throw a ball like up a hill. I guess you push a ball up a hill and it plays around with your kinetic energy and potential energy. Momentum is how long it takes to reduce, how long it takes for a force to reduce an object to zero velocity. And more intuition is momentum is an object's resistance to change. So if you think about like a really massive object traveling, it's really hard to change its velocity. And versus energy, which is the amount of work needed to move an object a certain speed. So in the energy, we're talking about like you have an object, right? If you wanted to move even faster, you have to like deposit some energy, or equivalently, you have to do some work. You have to like push the object over a distance and then it'll start to move faster. Momentum is more describing kind of like this reluctance to change. No worries if this doesn't make a lot of sense. Probably after going through some examples, it might start to understand. But the main thing to know is that this is like another tool. So we've done problems where, we use different concepts. Like we might apply energy to a problem, like a Newton's laws problem. Momentum is another tool that we can apply. So we're going to see a problem later where we do energy and momentum. We analyze a problem with both things. So just think of momentum as another tool in your toolkit. All right, I've rambled long enough. Let's get to the fun stuff. So recall that momentum is a vector quantity. So momentum is defined as mass times velocity. Now, mass is generally, mass stays the same, but velocity itself is a vector. So momentum is a scalar times a vector, so it's a vector. And just like earlier, we can split this up into x direction, y component, and z component, and we can analyze them separately too, and that's what we're going to end up doing. Units of momentum is kilograms, which is the same unit as mass, times meters per second, which is the same as velocity. Kilogram meters per second. And it turns out that if you write down Newton's law, force is equal to mass times acceleration, And you recognize that mass doesn't change, but we know acceleration is the derivative of velocity with respect to time. So from here to here, we just do A is equal to dv dt. And then from here to here, we recognize that m times dv is equal to dp. And this just comes straight from this formula that I wrote over here, where instead of taking taking lowercase p, we're taking a differential, a small piece of momentum. And with this said, force is equal to dp dt, or the change in momentum over time. All right, so when two or more particles in an isolated system interact, the total momentum of the system does not change. So in energy, we had a system, and then we had some agent that either did some work on the system or took some work out of the system. Very similar here. You have an isolated system. If it's isolated, there's no interaction, then the total momentum does not change. And what do we mean? We mean that there's no external force. So we can think of a cue ball striking another cue ball, spacecraft fires, rocket into space, and the nuclear fission or fusion. All right, so now there's this other concept called impulse. So we were talking about work with energy earlier, and now we're going to look at impulse. It's kind of similar things. So an impulse changes momentum. So with energy, you have potential energy and kinetic energy, and your work changes that. In this case, you have momentum, and impulse changes your momentum. So you can think of impulse that relates a force and how long it's applied. So a force acting for a long period of time will increase the momentum more than a force for a short period of time. And this is the formula, of course, for impulse. J, we're using J now, is equal to the integral of force over time. Integral of force with respect to time, not over as in divided, but you get the idea. So impulse is also the area of the force time graph. So if you have a graph over here, force and time, of course the integral, is the net signed area underneath it over here. So we can write it, you can just calculate the area. And impulse is equivalent to a change in momentum. And this is just from the previous slide over here. Like we stopped over here, we said force is equal to dp dt. And force is dp dt if we multiply both sides by dt, and then we get to here. And then if we integrate both sides and we define J as this quantity over here, we get momentum is equal to, we get a relationship between the total momentum, change in momentum, and impulse. All right, so just to recap, the definition of impulse is here, the integral of force with respect to time. Now, if the force is constant, of course, it's just F times delta T. If your force time graph over here, if your force is constant, like if it's like this, right, then you just have a box over here. So your total impulse, which is the area, is simply this delta t times the force, the area of the rectangle. And of course, if the mass doesn't change, then your impulse is equal to m delta v. So the impulse momentum theorem, which we kind of said earlier, is that F delta T equals M delta V, or impulse is a change in momentum. And this is very similar to the work energy theorem. So you can draw parallels between the two. All right. Yeah, another small point. So we were saying how impulse is the integral, so it would be the area underneath the curve, this force time graph. Another way, instead of saying we have this force, it's acting for 10 seconds, and every second it's this quantity here, the impulse will be the exact same if we just tell you what is the average force during that duration. So basically take this area under this curve and we morph it into a rectangle with starting point here and ending point here, and then I tell you this constant force value. So technically the force is in constant, but for our analysis, that's how they would say the problem. So in this case, you would look for the key phrase of like the time averaged net force. All right, so a little more intuition. So think of momentum as a quantity related to an object's resistance to change. It's m times v, so a really big object moving slow is hard to change. A really small object moving really, really, really fast is also hard to change. A small object moving slow versus a small object moving fast, like that's how I would think about it. So an object with a lot of momentum is hard to stop, and there exists conservation momentum, which is our new tool. And yeah, we have impulse also, which is how we can deliver extra momentum to a system. Now, the types of problems that we see with momentum are collision problems. And so collision problems tend to be like, you see a collision, you should think momentum is how we're gonna go about this. And there's two very extreme cases. So the one case is a cue ball is struck at another cue ball. So you can imagine a pool table, you know, you one ball hits the other ball, and right, and you can think about the after effect. The other extreme case is that a cue ball is struck at a ball made of duct tape. So it hits the cue ball, it hits the other ball, and now they're kind of stuck to each other, and they move together with some velocity. And yeah, so I'm gonna say a little bit better. So the first situation where you can think of, I just imagine a cue ball hitting another cue ball and they both like go into their own directions, it's called a perfectly elastic collision. It's elastic, right? It's elastic, perfectly elastic. And the reason why it's perfectly elastic is that in this situation here, kinetic energy is preserved. There's no loss of energy. So there's two things. This is a way that we're going to classify this collision problem, which is perfectly elastic. And the second thing is that a property of perfectly elastic collisions is that kinetic energy is preserved. So just remember that this kinetic energy is preserved is a property of this type of collision. The other extreme example is that, you know, the duct tape one. So in this case, we call it perfectly inelastic. The objects, and the definition is that the objects basically stick together after they collide, and the kinetic energy is not the same before and after. Think about like a really small ball, and like, you know, it's thrown at an elephant, and then they both collide and they move together with a really slow speed. Like the kinetic energy is not going to be conserved, because at the beginning your 1/2 mv squared is super high because of the v squared term, and then afterwards your kinetic energy, well, you have a big mass, but your velocity is like zero almost. Anyways, the third situation, which is kind of a hybrid of the two, but it falls more in situation two, is inelastic collision. So here, the objects do not stick together, but kinetic energy is not preserved either. So in this case, kinetic energy is preserved and they don't stick. Here they stick and kinetic energy is not the same. And here it has the property that kinetic energy is not preserved, but they also don't stick together. And the key thing here is like you look for the word deformity, like a rubber ball hits a hard surface, it gets slightly malformed, and then it goes back. And yeah, this is usually specified in the problem. So the key terms to kind of memorize are like the perfectly elastic, inelastic, perfectly inelastic. So the perfectlies are the two extremes, and the inelastic is like the hybrid of the two. Yeah, so in the inelastic collisions, right, inelastic is where they do not stick together and some kinetic energy is transferred away. Where does the kinetic energy go? So in this case, it's usually transferred out as like either sound or heat or something like that. Now, how are we going to solve these types of problems? So remember, we're solving collision kind of problems. And yeah, so basically we're going to classify the problem. So is this elastic or is it inelastic? Is it perfectly or is it not perfect? If it's elastic, right, I'll go back over here. So the elastic, we're gonna look to see is the kinetic energy the same before and after. If perfectly elastic means that. Perfectly inelastic masses can stick together after collision. Kinetic energy is not the same after. So we're gonna like think about all these things here. We're also gonna think, more generally, how many dimensions are there? Do we need to separate out into various dimensions? And then what we'll do is we'll write the before and after equations. We'll use conservation of momentum along with the fact. So we have two tools. So one is conservation of momentum. The other thing, very key thing, is that sometimes, if we go back over here, in a perfectly elastic collision, the kinetic energy is conserved. So I bet you there's going to be some problem you'll encounter sometime in life where it's a perfectly elastic collision, you write down the momentum equations, and then you're like, oh, I can't finish. But to actually solve the question, you need to remember that kinetic energy is also conserved. All right, so let's get started. The famous ballistic pendulum question. So the ballistic pendulum is an apparatus used to measure the speed of projectiles. A projectile of mass M1 is fired into a large block of wood of mass M2 suspended from some wa light wire. So that just means we can ignore the mass of the wires. M1, M2. The projectile embeds in the block and the entire system swings through a height h. What is the speed of the projectile? All right, so, and in short, something gets fired into this block here, it gets stuck in the block, and afterwards, the block moves up a little bit from this pendulum. And this difference here, we'll call it h, the height increase. So immediately off the bat, like, what am I thinking? I'm thinking, all right, I see a collision, I know this is a momentum problem. And then after I see that, I'm thinking, okay, what type of momentum is this? Is this going to be elastic, inelastic, perfect or not? I'm already observing right now that, the masses stick together. So, if I go back to the cheat sheet over here, here the masses do stick together in the perfectly inelastic case. In this case here, they don't stick together. So I'm thinking perfectly inelastic is probably what this type of collision is. Also thinking, how many dimensions are there? Well, there might be two dimensions, right? Because there is a height difference. But if you think about it, there's really only one dimension. There's only an x component here. Like your before and after, like your before is this mass traveling with some velocity, and then your after is both of them together moving with some velocity. Yes, it does swing up to a height here, but immediately after this mass gets embedded into this other mass, the system will move just a little bit, and that's like your after snapshot. So we don't care about the entire swing right now. We're just going to compare right afterwards, and in that case, the before and after are one dimension. I don't know if that made a lot of sense, but I'll just draw real quick. When they get embedded in, you can think of like this V after is like they're both of them together and how much they're moving. Yeah, so it's perfectly inelastic since the masses stick and there's one dimension. Yeah, another trick is that velocity, the final velocity is only in one dimension. There's no vertical component right after they get embedded together. All right. Let's start conservation of momentum. So remember, momentum is m times v. So we basically sum up the before and after. So before, the first mass is m1 is traveling with velocity v, and mass 2 has velocity 0, which is good. Gets rid of that term. And right afterwards, both of them travel at the exact same velocity, vb, But the mass is now m1 plus m2 because they're considered now like one mass. So if we solve for the velocity, we get vb is equal to this over here. All right, so we get this over here. Now, the other thing is conservation of energy. There's a difference here. So this is a perfectly inelastic collision. So if we go back up to the cheat sheet here, you'll see that perfectly inelastic collision, they do stick together and some kinetic energy is transferred away. What does that mean? It means that kinetic energy is not conserved, but we always know that the total energy is conserved. So total energy is kinetic plus potential energy. So we can still apply conservation of energy. We just don't have the fact that kinetic energy is the same before and after. All right, so let's just do that. So conservation of energy. And here we have to think, okay, so what are the before and after? What we'll do is we'll make the before this stage here when the masses are combined and it just moved a little bit, and the after stage will be when it's reached its total, you know, like the pendulum swings to a height h, and that's our after stage. So in the before stage, here where the masses are together, the total potential energy, we'll call that our, you know, reference of zero, that height will be zero over here. The kinetic energy, of course, is 1/2 mv², where this time our, I'll write it over here, so our u before is equal to 1/2 mv², where this time our mass is m1 plus m2, and our velocity is vb, which we just calculated to be this quantity here. So it'll be m1 V1A divided by M1 plus M2 squared. So, and believe me, you know, when you square it, like one of them cancels out with this quantity here, so you just ended up with this here. And the after stage, the total, this here flip-flopped, the total kinetic energy is zero because it's at a standstill, and the total potential energy is M1 plus M2 times G times H, because both masses are at a height h now, the difference in height. So let's see, we know what the masses are, and g we know, and I believe h was given, so this is good. So now we're given these two, so we're given, this is our conservation of, this is from our conservation of momentum, and this over here is from our conservation of energy. And combining those two equations, we can solve for V1A, and we end up getting this here. So, yeah. So the speed of the projectile, which is we labeled as V1A, we can figure that out. And you can think of like the practical application of this, like if you have some, you know, you have some projectile and you want to figure out the speed of it, right? It's a lot easier to, you know, calculate the height and measure both masses, because all you need to know here is h and the masses. In fact, you probably don't even have to measure this mass if you want an approximate value. You can just measure this one here. So this is a pretty cool practical application. You can get the speed of something just by firing it into a big mass here and looking at this, looking at how much it moves it in a vertical direction. Pretty cool. And we use this intermediary result, this VB over here, as a way of solving. All right, here's another example. So this one's a little bit more interesting. So we have two objects. They slide over a frictionless surface. So I'm missing over here. There's a mass 2 originally that's over here. So basically, you have a mass m1, and it's fired into mass m2, and then right afterwards, These two over here describe like the after effect. So, you shoot this over here, and then M2 goes this way, and M1 will go this way over here. And they both make a 30-degree angle, 30 degrees. And we're giving some information. So we're given mass one is 5 kilograms. We're given the initial speed of this mass over here. And we know mass two, which is at rest at the center, is 2.5 kilograms. And we also know that this here is an angle 30 degrees. Okay, so we're asked, is this collision elastic or inelastic? So we want to classify this collision. All right, maybe think for a second. I'm going to scroll back up to the cheat sheet so we can go through the different options. All right, so what I would do is I would think about like, are they sticking together or not? So in this case here, perfectly inelastic that we just looked at, they do stick together, and in our problem they don't, so it's not this. Now, the real question then is this perfectly elastic or is it inelastic? So the only difference here is that in perfectly elastic, the kinetic energy is the same before and after. And in an inelastic collision, the kinetic energy is not, like some of it's transferred away. So what I'm thinking is that we can eyeball it and say it's, one of these two, but we have to figure out now about this kinetic energy business. Is this gonna be transferred away or not? And it should be easy, right? Because kinetic energy is just 1/2 mv². So I think we could just calculate the before and after, and if it's the same, then we're good. Let's see. So just to recap real quick, it's probably not perfectly inelastic because the masses do not stick together. But we have to figure out, is it perfectly elastic or is it inelastic? And we're going to use conservation of momentum to help us figure out the final velocity. So they're not giving it to us for free. I copy the question over here in case you have to reference it. Kinetic energy before is 1/2 mv² of the first mass. We're given m1 and we're given v1. And the kinetic energy of the second mass is at rest, so it's actually zero. And if you plug this in, you get, 50.63 joules. And we can't find the final kinetic energy just yet because we don't know the final velocities of both objects. So at this point, I would start to think like, all right, how do we figure this out? And I would think of all the available tools that we have. So I would think of this conservation of energy makes sense here. No, of course not, because that's what we're trying to find. We're trying to find the final kinetic energy. So and there's no like there's no this all takes place, by the way, in a plane. There's no like there wouldn't be any change in potential energy for anything either. So of course not. Now this momentum, conservation of momentum makes sense. Well, of course, because this is the chapter on momentum. I'm gonna give you a problem on momentum. Just kidding. The momentum is making sense to me because we are given masses and we are interested in finding velocities, and momentum deals with both of those, only both of those. So now that we know it's conservation momentum, I have to think about how to actually go about and solve this. And the first thing that I think about is, what is this problem? Is this in 1D or is it in 2D? So naively you would think it's, one dimensional because the velocity vector is, one. It's in just the x direction. But if you think of the after stage, they're both, moving, and they both have some y component aspect to them too. So it's actually a two-dimensional problem. Yeah, so what we'll do is we'll split this up into x and y dimension, and we'll analyze those separately. So in the x dimension, this is here is the before momentum. It's just m1 times v1 because the second object is at rest. So you would have a mass 2 times the velocity of 0. The final velocity, so this here is the final momentum, is just M1 times V final, which is what? Well, it's the V final is this vector over here. The x component of this velocity is just V final times the cosine of this angle. So it'd be, you know, we're interested in this component of velocity. So it'd be V times cosine theta. Same thing with M2 over here. And the y axis, well, what is the momentum here? So here I actually simplified it because the before momentum is zero because there's no vertical component of velocity. But afterwards, you can see that these two are kind of competing. So this is the y component of the velocity of M2. And this over here is the y component of velocity of M1. And if you just write it out, like without simplifying, it would be, you know, 0 is equal to M2, right, times sine of theta. And then if this here is theta, you know, this here would technically be minus theta. So you would have M2 sine theta plus M1 times sine of minus theta. And from trigonometry, sine of minus theta is equal to minus sine of theta. So you have M1 times sine of theta. And that's equal to 0. And then you can put, you know, this term on the other side, and you end up getting this over here. Cool. So now we have these two. We can solve the system of equations. So, you know, we know what M1 is. We know V1i. Yeah, we know all the masses, the velocities, we know the starting velocity, we know theta, we just don't know VF2 and VF1. And, you know, two equations with two unknowns, so we can solve and we get this over here. Now, why did we solve this again? Oh, right, we want to figure out, is kinetic energy conserved? So, I think we have all the tools now. We know all the masses, we know the beginning, and we know the final velocity. So now it's pretty easy. You just plug it in. So the final kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared, where the v's are now the final velocities. So we just plug in the numbers that we just computed, and we get 50.63, which is the exact same thing as initially that we got, the initial kinetic energy. So in this case, the final and the beginning kinetic energy are the same. So the collision is perfectly elastic. And just to recap again, what we did was we classified the question. We know that they're not sticking, but now we had two choices, right? And in one choice, the kinetic energy is conserved, and the other choice, the kinetic energy is not conserved. So the way that we could figure this out is to actually compute the kinetic energy. And we could prove that it's the exact same. And this is how we could conclude that this collision is perfectly elastic. So the moral of the story here is that we don't want to make assumptions on whether or not the collision is... Like, we don't want to make assumptions in general on the type of collision. And the best thing to do is to actually do this computation. And of course, if the question says, like, you know, this is a perfectly elastic or this is a perfectly inelastic collision, you know, then you don't have to do any of this. So yeah, so I hope this was helpful, a little shorter session. Thank you all for coming, thank you for watching, and we'll see you next week.